Right. Let's get started. Welcome, everyone. Welcome to AGL Live. I'm Melinda Burgess, Director of Communications for AGL, and I'll start us off by telling you a little bit more about our organization. AGL is a nonprofit association working to help government modernize through shared knowledge and community. You can visit our website at agilegovernors.org. I'm getting a bit of an echo, so if everyone mutes that's not talking, that'd be awesome. I'm going to drop that link in the chat as well for you. And that's where you can learn more about our organization and our work and the ways you can get involved with other government practitioners. We have a membership program with collaboration and learning opportunities to help empower private and public sector folks in their careers and their innovation efforts. And that comes with free access to events like this and other benefits. Today we're here to discuss Battle of the Frameworks, choosing the right Agile approach for your government project. And we know it's not really a battle. There's probably going to be some fun jesting, but as we all know, these are tools in a toolbox. And we have a fantastic panel of folks here today coming from various perspectives on these different types of government projects and approaches. We did have some shifting in the panel participants as some of our original folks were unable to make it today, but thankfully we do have a good representation here. For the different frameworks, although not the gender balance on the panel that we would normally aim to have. But we are so grateful for these folks here today who are taking time to help us learn a little bit more about these Agile approaches, and I'll let them introduce themselves in just a moment. A couple of quick notes before we start. At the end of the discussion, we do have a book giveaway, so stick around for that to find out if you've won a free copy of Jim Benson's book, Personal Kanban, which we thought was fitting for today's topic. And as the discussion's going on, I want to remind you that we're welcoming audience questions in the chat during the discussion, so feel free to use the chat icon at the bottom of your screen to open the chat window and add your questions, and we'll try to work them into the discussion. Keep your mic muted, but feel free to use video if you'd like. We are all here to learn together, and it's nice to see your faces. So with that, I will hand it over to our moderator, Dave Witkin, to introduce himself and get things started.
Great. Thanks, Melinda. Again, welcome, everybody, to the AGL Association Battle of the Agile Frameworks. We will try to have a good time with it. Like she said, it's obviously not a battle, but we're going to talk a little bit about what the different frameworks are, and when they're appropriate to use, and maybe not appropriate to use in a government context. So let's go ahead and jump right in with our panel, and we're gonna start brief introductions. Brent, why don't you kick us off? Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hey, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Brent Weaver. I am the director now of the ESRD Quality Reporting Systems at the Center for Medicaid and Medicare Services. I came to CMS about 2.5 years ago, from the private sector, specifically with the role of coming in to help with the agile transformation for CCSQ. So I've spent the last 2.5 years evolving from waterfall project methodologies to agile and now into SAFe.
Excellent. All right. Thank you, Brent. Joey, let's move on to you. Joey, a Kanban trainer.
Yeah, thanks so much. My name is Joey Spooner. I'm a Kanban trainer and coach, and I've been doing it for about 10 years now. Working in federal space as well as commercial and nonprofit, and most recently with the Department of Labor, helping them to really pick up and move a lot faster with Kanban. So I'm looking forward to this battle today, and hopefully I'll win. I don't know.
Remains to be seen, Joey. All right, fair enough. And last but not least, we have Mr. John Stone. John.
Hi. Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm John Stone. Director and also an Agile coach with a private sector group. I've been involved in Agile since around 1999, and in around 2008, actually involved in the Scrum team. Pretty much held every role, so I've been a developer, a tester, a Scrum master, now a coach. Currently helping the department in one of the largest Agile transformations they've ever done.
Excellent. And you may have noticed John Stone is actually British. We won't hold that against him, but as he said, he does do a lot of work here. I know a lot of our folks are U.S.-based, so John is doing a lot of Agile transformation work here in the U.S., right, John?
Yeah, I'm actually a U.S. citizen at this point. Kind of came over and never looked back.
Excellent. Fantastic. Thanks, John, and for allowing me to tease with you. All right, so before we jump into the panel, we've got a little bit of a context setting for you. what we hear a lot of us go into different agencies, government institutions, and we hear people tell us, I know Agile. And that sounds great. The way people talk about it almost sounds like it's a single thing. And at least according to the Software Engineering Institute, and I tend to agree with this, most of us don't consider it one thing. If it is any one thing, it's four values and 12 principles. But what those four values and 12 principles don't tell us is how we apply that information. So when somebody says, I know Agile, one of the first things we do as consultants is try to dig in and understand what do they really mean by that. And invariably, you know, or at least the vast majority of the time, what they mean is they understand one or more of the methods that are up on the screen right now. So Craig Smith, just to hammer it home, has sort of shown us there's a minimum, I think there's a few more than this now, but a minimum of 40 different methods that people consider to be within that Agile umbrella, that family. And we're going to talk about a few of those today. Some of those popular in government. Scrum is probably the most popular team level Agile framework. We've got Kanban, Joey's going to represent today. And many of you have probably heard of SAFe or the Scaled Agile Framework. So those three are very big in government today. So we are going to start with those. And who knows, we may have future sessions where we cover some of the others based on folks' interest. All right. And with that, I think we're going to start with a quick audience vote. We want to give our panel a sense of what do you know today? So I believe I am going to get control to share this poll. I think I have it. So a poll should be popping up for you right now. And we're going to give you a few seconds, and I'm going to run through what this poll says. Oops. Let's see. We've actually got the, I apologize. I've got the wrong poll up there. Let me try this again. Here it is. Experience with the approaches. So we want to get a sense of what's your experience with each one of these approaches, starting with SAFe. So, you know, just generic things. Would you say you crawl with SAFe, walk, or run? If you don't know anything about it, you can just choose crawl. And then the same with Scrum. And finally, with Kanban as well. And we've also got one down here for human-centered design. We won't talk as much about that today. But if you're familiar with human-centered design, go ahead and give us your expertise on that as well.
And are folks able to vote on that right now? I couldn't make it work for me. I was curious if anyone else is having struggles or if it's working for you all.
It does appear to be working. We're getting a number of responses.
Yay.
Positive. All right. So I'm going to give folks just another second or two on SAFe, Scrum, and Kanban. And why don't we go ahead and we've taken about a minute. Why don't we go ahead and end polling? And it looks like, I don't know if you guys can see this, but it looks like the Scale Agile Framework, the majority of people say they're crawl. So they don't have a strong knowledge of SAFe. With Scrum, we've got a good number of people that feel like they're running with it. So they know it pretty well, which is great. And I'm sort of in the middle. So we've got some walk, run, and a few crawl as well. And same, actually, a little bit more of the crawl with human-centered design. Which is great. So that gives our panelists some idea of how to frame the discussions today. And we're going to move into that right now. So each one of the panelists, go to the next slide. Each one of the panelists is going to represent one framework. So John Stone is going to represent Scrum for us today. And so he's going to take a few minutes, introduce Scrum, and then we'll do the other frameworks as well. So John, why don't you jump in?
Okay, sure. So I'll actually somewhat adjust my presentation based on the polling that came back. I'm not going to go into detail through all the various steps of this. Scrum in itself, there's tons of information out there, almost too much, I find. To Dave's point, when groups say they know Agile, they're typically talking about Scrum, I tend to find, when I go into an agency or a commercial industry. But it's effectively a way to kind of make that list of work you need to do, plan that work, execute a small iteration, whether you're doing one-day sprints or three-week sprints. I've also seen month-long sprints, which sometimes makes me cringe a little bit in government. But the idea is you're getting that fast feedback. At the end of that, you're also going to review that with typically your product owners and your stakeholders to get feedback. And the idea is you're just repeating that cycle. Through that whole cycle, you're also checking in. So you're having these daily scrums. I've seen them done in person, virtually. There's idea in industry right now to effectively
once
do
you get to the last fourth one.
Hey, for everybody on the line, definitely appreciate it.
If you,
thank you.
CIO.
You make me the host again. I can mute people that aren't.
Sorry, I'll just wait till we've got mute people.
That's what Melissa was asking. It's kind of.
And this is why we prefer to do daily scrums in person than virtually. some of the key takeaways with Scrum is that it adds a level of structure that usually works well with from a government perspective. So you'll hear when Joey talks about Kanban, it's a lot looser. There's a lot less rules in place. I tend to find Scrum works well as a kind of very good discovery agile practice to follow, because it allows you to see kind of what's working, what's actually going to stick with an organization. One of the benefits of it as well is it's very easy to digest. In a nutshell, this is it on the screen. I've actually been to some agencies where this is what they took and they ran with that. They received no training, nothing formal. That usually runs into some issues of its own, but it is very simple. One of the things I've always said is it's very easy to put in place, but it can be difficult to master. Especially if you kind of follow that regular mindset that we see where you just pick someone on the team and you say, okay, you're the Scrum Master, and you pick somebody else and you say, well, you're the government folk. You're going to be the product owner. Okay, go do Scrum. That's where we usually run into the biggest issues from a government rollout standpoint. Some of the places I've seen it done well, so I was actually part of a Scrum team at FDA. We actually got it to the point where we could execute very effectively on task orders we got from the government. It took a number of years to get there. It was not a quick transformation process, but it was to an extent the government allowing us to kind of explore that. We went to the government and said, we want to do Scrum. And they basically said, what's that? So there was a lot of education going on from Scrum itself. One thing I've been told to touch on is Scrumfall, and it's probably the biggest pitfall I see in Scrum is basically putting time boxes around your waterfall process. You see instances where you'll have a team say, well, we're going to do a sprint of requirements, then we'll do a sprint of design, then we'll do a sprint of development and test, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's not true Scrum. There's actually a few things that have come out about how to spot fake agile or fragile or Scrumfall, Scrumish, Scrumbut. There's a ton of terms out there. We often see that in a government environment where it's that, oh, by doing the ceremonies, we are agile. And I've often said there's a huge difference between doing agile and actually being agile. So my 4 minutes is up, so I will pass it over to Joey.
All right, thank you very much. So, kind of like what Jonathan was saying, Kanban is a little looser than Scrum, but it actually has a lot of benefit in that way. I agree with him that when I talk about Kanban to people, I say, well, it's a bit like a can opener, right? And so is Scrum. So if you look at Scrum, it's got a great recipe. It will deliver. So in this case, it's a little bit like a powered can opener. That thing will crank out and help people execute really well. When I look at Kanban, I say, well, it's kind of like a Boy Scouts can opener. It doesn't have electricity with it. It doesn't have, you know, a place to where you put the can necessarily. But if you give it to someone who actually has a bit of a creative mindset, you can probably launch a rocket with it or something like that, because it's quite open and flexible. And that's what the idea is behind evolutionary improvement for the Kanban method. So a lot of what we do is actually manage things. So while we're friends with the other frameworks out there, we tend to focus more on managing improvement and how to do that effectively. So we're more of looking at things like a service rather than a team. In fact, we may have teams of teams that actually form into a service. Those are connected together inside a business, and we look at how we improve that overall inside a business. So within the government area of the federal space, we've seen it used within the Department of Labor, where we've actually improved performance by about anywhere between 85 and 95% for like things like governance, software development, Now it's being used, I want to say, in commercial industries quite a bit, in fact, in banking and finance, for improvement of delivery of technology, and also in marketing spaces. So there's a lot going on there behind the scenes with the method itself. Now, the next slide's probably a better way of explaining what Kanban is. There are really just a handful of techniques you can use to get started. And this is where I think kind of like what John's looking for, sort of the, yeah, it's loose. So it does have some benefit. The first thing, which a lot of people typically do, is unhide the work. They visualize what they're working on. They put out the truth of what's really going on and what they've said yes to. So I imagine a number of you on the call today are probably thinking, okay, I've said yes to a lot of things. Well, did you keep track of that? Some of you do, some of you may not, some of you might forget. So we try and visualize that first and foremost. The next thing that we try to get into, which is very hard for a lot of people to do, is managing it and actually limiting how much you say yes to. A lot of people have a hard time saying no. And what I think the method has done really well for a number of businesses and government agencies is help them to understand that midpoint, kind of like what John was talking about with the product owner. Where do you say yes and where do you say not yet? And that's a very good thing that we do these days. Now, the next couple of things we do here are just actually keeping work moving along. So a lot of things that, you know, you saw on the Scrum Daily, the Scrum meeting, I believe that's what it's still called, or the daily stand-up meeting. We have a similar thing, but we also do it throughout the day and throughout the week, making sure that things that are delayed get removed or resolved fairly quickly. The last thing here, or the next thing that we do, is actually having policies. So as we start to evolve and figure out how do we say yes, when do we say yes, also when do we actually start delivering things, maybe also is it really finished? Sometimes we think it's done, but it's not done. Those are things that get pulled out and brought into a system that's visualized. We also have those feedback loops. So in more informal groups, they tend to have feedback loops that already exist. Sometimes that's Scrum moving to Kanban, and they'll say, we want to keep our Scrum ceremonies, by all means. Sometimes it's groups who say, we don't have anything. And we say, okay, maybe you ought to try a review meeting for risks first and foremost. What are the things that are slowing you down? We also get into performance. So how long does it take you to get something done on average is a big conversation we typically have. Around that is the relationship of these other services that are running across inside a business. And we're looking at that interdependent relationship and saying, how do we optimize that for your goals, for your fitness, for your business? And last but not least, a really fun thing here is actually talking. So one of the biggest things I think I find that comes out of Kanban is actually having some seriously good conversations that are challenging to have about the truth of how your business is running and what you're dealing with as far as demand and management of that demand. Typically that brings itself into what are called Kaizen events or ideas for how to improve. Some people actually use experimentation to do that kind of improvement where they say, let's empirically try one thing. Let's try and do this differently. In the government space, it might be something like, let's go to DOJ's, I forget the name of the system now, something like CSAM or something like that, where we have to file incidents and reports, and let's do a little something different there before we file that report, so it's a little faster or a little cleaner, more easier to read. So those are the kind of things that typically you'll find taking place in a given Kanban system or service that's running inside a business. And that's just a little introduction into what Kanban is. There's a heck of a lot more to it. If you look on your right side of your screen there, you'll probably see a short little link. That is something for people who want to get a little bit of training. I've got training coming up next month. So if you want to learn a little bit more in DC, that's where you can find more about it.
Outstanding. Thank you, Joey. Why don't we move on to Brent. Brent, talk to us a little bit about SAFE.
Awesome. Thanks, Dave. So as you can see by this diagram, which was pulled directly from the Scaled Agile Framework website, SAFE is somewhat a little bit more complicated. You know, Melinda, I did want to touch on, Melinda noted earlier that this really isn't a battle of the frameworks. And the main reason for that, the reason it's not a battle is because SAFE would win. Sorry, Joe. Sorry, John.
This is good.
But in all seriousness, SAFE was constructed because back in the early 2000s, teams recognized that Agile was great for delivering solutions at the team level, but it really wasn't working for large-scale projects with multiple teams. One of the great things about Scrum, and one of the things we learned, is small team sizes actually help teams perform better. So instead of just making one large team of Agile, Scrum, or Kanban, what the SAFE organization did was came up with a framework to help us scale using things like Scrum and Kanban. And they do this really by promoting coordination, synchronization, collaboration among the delivery teams, the product management, business owners, and the customers, as you see them all going from left to right. And like I said, it's important to note that this isn't an alternative to Scrum necessarily, because it utilizes Scrum. It just scales it out at a large level. Typically, we find that SAFe is a good solution when you have an enterprise solution that consists of 50, 100, 125 developers all working towards the same outcome. So we have 4 minutes. I didn't want to go too much into what SAFe is. We could be here all day with that. But I did want to touch on some of the unique attributes of SAFe. And in comparison to Scrum and Kanban, SAFe actually promotes planning out a little bit further. So you'll notice that they talk about things like 9-month roadmaps. They do 3-month program increments. So you plan your work a little bit further out than you would traditionally with a Scrum or Kanban approach. And the roadmap thing is important in the government space, at least here at CMS, because what we have found by planning things out 3 increments or 9 months at a time, we can predict what type of task orders we need to get out on the street so that in 6 months when we go to start that work, we have contractors in hand to do that work. Another nice thing about SAFe, just like Kanban and Scrum, it's freely available. You can go out to the Scaled Agile Framework website and actually just read all about it right there. And because it was built on Lean, I find that SAFe actually complements our DevOps culture very well. We're trying to establish more automation in the government, and through that Lean mindset, DevOps overlaps it very, very well. I will talk real quick about a couple little lessons learned around implementing SAFe in the government space. The image you're seeing right now is what they call the essential SAFe. It's the scaled back version. We always recommend starting there. And then the other biggest lesson we learned, scaling bad agile practices is bad. So just because you go say, oh, I'm going to go do SAFe, if you weren't doing Scrum correctly and you go to scale that out, you're actually only making it worse. The other big thing we've learned is SAFe advocates we bring everybody together in one room every 10 to 12 weeks for planning purposes. And we've seen where the government tries to say, well, we'll just bring in the leads, we'll just bring in the Scrum Masters. And again, it doesn't work. We've seen it time and time again. You get to a confidence vote at the end of a PI planning session and you have no confidence because the people doing the work weren't actually there. And I will note too that SAFe, while it sounds great, it fits well with our governance model here in the government. There is a heavy tax you have to pay to using SAFe. So if you don't have a larger solution, you're running 1-2 teams and that's it. Really, there's no need to scale out on SAFe because all these extra events actually just cause more time and delays in your releases.
Excellent. Thank you, Brent. When you said, you know, you joked that SAFe is the best, I thought it was going to be because you can see down here on the diagram, SAFe already includes Kanban and Scrum right on the picture. So obviously they take all that into account. But excellent overview, obviously a little more complicated. So let's dive in a little bit more. So now you know a little bit about the 3 frameworks we're going to talk about. And we're going to test your knowledge a little bit. There is, for each of these frameworks, right, you can say some may be more fit for a given purpose than others. That's part of why we want to do this here with you today. We want to give you a sense where one might fit and others do not. So I am going to launch this poll. Hopefully it's in front of you now, called Fitness for Purpose. And I'll read off the scenarios very briefly. We've got 3 scenarios. One is we've got a team that needs to manage a large list of production defects. We get new defects every day. We need to triage and prioritize them. What approach might we use? I'll give you guys just a second. Go ahead and start filling that in. I'll move to the next one. If you don't know, perfectly fine as well. And I will tell you, some of our panelists may argue that it's not just one framework that could be used for this. Obviously, I think there's probably one right answer, but I'll leave that to them. The second one is the local government has about 15 people tasked with building and rolling out a new software application. And it's going to be used by about 10,000 users. What approach might be a good fit for that? And then last but not least, third one, we have about 400 people working on a huge project to build an enterprise software application. Which of those three frameworks might be a good fit? All right. And I'll give folks just about another second or two to tally their votes. Thank you for participating. We still got one or two more coming in. All right, excellent. So I'm gonna end polling now. And let's see what we got. So for the first scenario with production defects, the majority of folks thought Kanban might be a good approach. And Joey, maybe talk a little bit about that. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I've seen Kanban used for operational things like this all the time, where they have to handle a number of defects and they have to actually triage them effectively. Typically, we find this with production teams that already do software development at the same time, which is kind of fun. So we'll find that they have to allocate a certain amount of their limited work in progress to something like defects. But typically, when we see defects coming through on the outside, we call that failure demand. And we start to look at that and say, okay, well, what's the common cause behind that? And how do we actually reduce that kind of demand? Because we actually have an ability to influence it and shape it in some form. So for example, you might find that 75% of a development team's effort is focused on writing new software, but 25% is dedicated to these defects. So you could have something like 8 user stories in process with 1 or 2 maybe getting out the door in the next day or 2 or 3. And then suddenly here comes a flood or 1 or 2 or 3 defects that they now have to triage and process at a higher level of service, usually within 24 hours or sometimes less than 8 hours, depending on what kind of a property it is online. So yeah, that's pretty common to see that.
Excellent. All right, let's hit the next one. So we've got a team of about 15 and they're developing a software application for 10,000 users. By far, most of the people thought Scrum would be the best fit. What say you, John Stone?
Yeah, I mean, Scrum, or I would argue Kanban, because we're looking at a small group of people. From my perspective, that would be 2 Scrum teams. 15 people on a single team would be too much, because I've got to assume that that doesn't include the Scrum Master and Product Owner, or they're going to assign a couple of those folks. And it will allow them to work in close proximity, that you're not going to run into a lot of those scaling issues that you'd need to handle under something like Less or Safe or one of the other scaling methods. Like Brent was basically saying, if you've only got a couple of teams, you really don't need the extra overhead of scaled approaches. You can just get by with Scrum, maybe blend in some of those Kanban things that Joey's talking about.
Excellent. All right. Sounds like you largely agree. Then let's hit the last one. We have a unanimous vote here. We've got 400 people working on a huge project, and 100% of the folks, Brent, said, we think safe is the right fit. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think it's obvious, because when you're dealing with that large of a number of people, we all know about lines of communication and how that works. So there's a lot of coordination that needs to take place. I think it is the obvious answer. I think too, what you would notice in a project like that is you would probably see both Scrum and Kanban being used within that scaled agile approach. A lot of times your development teams will be running Scrum, and you'll have O&M or operations and maintenance teams who will be utilizing Kanban, or shared services teams who will utilize Kanban to work in conjunction. But obviously, when you have that many people, there's a lot of coordination that takes place.
But I think that's a great point, Brent. I'll just highlight that very briefly to say, one of the things you said in there is these things may not be mutually exclusive. We talk about them as they are, but you may have one project that's using both some people using a Kanban approach and other people using a Scrum approach, all within rolled within that overall safe approach. So, excellent. Well, I tell you what, we'll stop sharing these results and we will move on to the next part of our discussion, which is our panel Q&A. So again, I think Melinda already mentioned to you guys in the audience, please, you can type your questions into the chat window. If they're targeted for a certain person on the panel, let us know that as well, and we'll try to get to those. But we're gonna start with some questions we've already talked about with the panelists, and again, sort of focusing on fitness for purpose. So John Stone, let's start with you. Talk about, for Scrum, an area where Scrum is commonly used in government, and talk about the types of problems it's very effective at solving.
Okay, so I tend to find when I'm working with the agencies, and not just government, just generally, is when it's a fairly small project, like we mentioned in the question, when it's about 15 people, to give you an example where I've actually been on Scrum teams, we had a fairly small project over at FDA, which was basically one team was building an input system, another one was building a tracking and workflow management system, and another team was dealing with the BI reporting aspect of it. We split those out into three Scrum teams and worked effectively together. As we matured, we had to pull in some things you find out are safe, like Scrum or Scrums, to allow a level of coordination. That's where it fits well. It also works well if you know that you're not going to be impacted with too much change over the course of your sprint. One of the things I start asking teams whether they should think about Kanban or Scrumban, i.e. that whole blending of approaches or switching approaches, is if I see large amounts of disruption within their sprint. So if they're committing to a sprint and then day two of the sprint, somebody's coming in and sidebarring the team with a bunch of extra work, or all the priorities keep changing, another approach may be a better fit for them.
Excellent. Joey, what about you? What do you think about that? Based on what John said, where does Kanban come in?
I'm going to have to say that it kind of comes in different areas. So playing off what John said, it definitely has a place where there's a bit more chaos. You need to stabilize around chaos. I've taken teams that are completely unreliable and made them reliable. I didn't make them, but helped them to become reliable, really, using this approach. So one of the things we did back at the Department of Labor, as an example, was they were pretty crazy with a lot of demand. They had a lot of White House type demand that came through to them as well. So they had a higher level of priority. Sometimes it would trump other plans. And initially they tried to use Scrum, which was, you know, fairly well. I mean, it worked reasonably well for them, but at some point they realized that they wanted to have a little bit more flexibility with managing their demand. And kind of like what John was saying, they kept having demand that would break their sprints. So they said, hey, how about we take this Kanban stuff and actually use it a little bit more flexibly with our demand management? And that's what they did. And they actually became predictable to a point where I was forecasting out 90 plus days on their productivity for how much they could handle. So something like that kind of ties into what Brent was talking about, where he says safe might win. I would say that you could do Kanban without safe if you really wanted to. You could untie those braces and say, okay, I'm going to go for it. And we've seen organizations at the 20,000 person level actually use Kanban enterprise wide to do planning and forecasting and management of work, much like what he's talking about. So I kind of want to throw a box back at him and say, well, that's true. You can use SAFE. You can use a lot of PI planning. And I have seen small individual groups burn out on PI planning because they're like, goodness gracious, that's a lot to handle. But if I take an organization like Microsoft or BBVA Bank in Spain, or it's an international bank, or we take something like Ping An out of China, which is a major insurance and banking company, they're all about somewhere between 15 and 20,000 people. And they're actually starting to use Kanban enterprise-wide to do their software development management planning, product management, services for like legal and procurement to actually improve their performance. So I would have to say that, you know, in light of that, you can use Kanban very simply. And that's where a lot of people get introduced to it, to help kind of stabilize the crazies. And that's kind of where this little chart behind me kind of picks into the picture, because at the very top of this picture is sort of the things that are on fire. And that's the Kanban maturity model. So a lot of people will probably find themselves just a little bit beyond on fire, where they're a little bit more stable. And then at the very bottom is sort of like they can basically take a punch, kind of like in this meeting right now. I can throw a punch at them, and this company could survive some pretty challenging times. So we tend to find that there's a broader application of it outside of the U.S. actually, and there's more traction gaining in the U.S. around how to use this at an enterprise level.
Excellent. Thank you, Joey. So Brent, you gotta help me out here. So Kanban can handle organizations with 10 or 20,000 people. You just heard it from Joey Spooner. What do we need SAFE for?
So he makes great points. And what it really comes down to, in my opinion, and I'm going to try to answer one of the poll questions at the same time, it comes down to really maturity. And so, what Joey's talking about is running Kanban at that level requires a really high level of Kanban maturity. And one of the things I think SAFe does very well is out of the box, you can use it for less mature shops so that they, as they become more and more mature, what we've noticed is a transformation and a melding of all the different philosophies. You know, even here at CMS, we've sort of got our own flavor of SAFe now after we've been through enough iterations to know how do we need to tweak it so that it matches more of our government architecture.
Yeah. Excellent. So I tell you what, let me throw that back to John Stone. One of the things that Brent just talked about really is tailoring the methodology. So that's clearly something you can do with something like SAFe, right? What about with Scrum though? Do we tailor methodologies in Scrum?
Yeah. So give you a good example. So teams that do get a level of disruption, especially as Joey mentioned, you've just put something out to production. You can expect a level of defects to start coming in. You can start basically limiting what you commit to in that planning for that next sprint and say, okay, let's just reserve some capacity. We know we've got work in our backlog we can pull from. That's not really a Scrum concept. That's more of a work in process concept. You're limiting your WIP intentionally to make sure you've got room to address production defects as they arise. Then if you're getting like halfway through your sprint, nothing's coming up, everything's looking good, you've got a backlog of work you can just start pulling from. So that's where you start seeing blends of this. I've stood up teams to use Scrumban, as Jerry mentioned. Scrum just wasn't working, and you keep some of the key Scrum philosophies in place. So, okay, we're still going to plan every 2 weeks and have a demo, but we're not going to follow like that rigid commitment. We're going to allow for a level of change to happen over the course of our sprint. You start blending some of these things in, and you can do the same even within SAFe itself. I've seen aspects of less come into play in SAFe. I've seen SAFe implementations that are heavier on the lean side of things than they are on Scrum or Kanban. I think one of the biggest failings I've seen in government is picking a framework or an approach and going, this is how we're going to do it, and it is never going to change. We're going to follow it to the letter and expect it to work. It's the whole, well, we want to be like Spotify. The first thing I fire back is, are you Spotify? Because if you're not, it's not going to work. Like, they tailored that process heavily for the way their organization was structured. It's not going to work very well outside of Spotify. You can take theories and concepts from it and try and apply it, but you're not Spotify. So stop trying to be Spotify.
Hey, Jonathan, this is Brent. That's very well said, and couldn't agree anymore. And that's sort of the approach. We say you have to be very deliberate. So you take the framework as it's taught to you, and then you move from that academic to a realistic implementation based on deliberate choices. So one of the things we did see a lot in the government is they would say, oh, well, we're going to mold it this way because that's the way we sort of always done things. What we challenge people to do is you can change the framework or the methodology, but you got to be deliberate in how you do so. You have to call out why, what's the problem you're trying to solve by doing that. But I think John was spot on there.
Excellent. Well, I tell you what, Brent, let me throw it back to you for one more related question from our audience. We got a question in about, from Alexa, about, you know, given that you talked about Kanban might be an easy thing to implement, Joey talked about it for less mature organizations, how do we go about implementing something like SAFe at a government agency?
You fail a lot. So that's from personal experience.
Appreciate the honesty.
So and what it is, it's a lot. It's a number of factors. First and foremost, it's leadership buy-in, that you're going to change the way you're doing things and they're going to be okay with it. You need to have your employees around you, your government employees, more engaged. Not more engaged, but they need to be engaged throughout the whole process. That's where we've seen it be successful. To tell a contractor to go implement SAFe and come back with your end results is no different than the old throw it over the wall and show me what you come back with. It's really creating that collaborative environment. So some of the things that we've done is restructured contracts to be more aligned so that they deliver, they have more agile, SAFe-like deliverables, even calling out program increment objectives as part of the deliverables they're held to. The other thing you have to do is you have to be diligent. You have to be able to say, all right, this is going to be really painful, but it'll get better after the next increment and the next increment.
Excellent. All right. Thank you. So I tell you what, Joey, why don't we throw it over to you? One of the things that comes up a lot, I'm fond of saying that Agile is not magic, right? And a lot of doing it effectively relies on the customer. So in Kanban, how do you engage the customer?
That's a great question. So for customer engagement, it can come a couple of different ways. There could be the product development scenario where you're trying to build a product. And if you guys go out to YouTube and look up something called Optimizely Lean Kanban North America 2017, or just Optimizely Kanban, you'll probably find a video on how they actually did all of that, from product development ideas to actual product execution, with about, I want to say, 200 or 300 people, somewhere in that category, in one visualization, which is really neat to see. But as far as roles go, there's something that keeps popping up, which we tend to call a service request manager. And they're the ones who are really handling some of the demands coming from the customers. They could be direct contacts with the customers. They could be major buyers. They could actually be people who are doing work in the field on a product improvement idea, and they come back with results like UX researchers and things like that. So it varies quite a bit, but we do have that kind of role where the customers are represented. If you take one step beyond that and really get into the business side of it and say, well, how does the business grow and improve with Kanban connected together? We do have this concept called, I hate to tag on to the slide deck here, but we do have this concept called fitness for purpose. And it's actually a book out there now that really gets into it quite a bit. So we do tend to look at how are we wanting to be as a business, where do we want to go, and then what customers do we want to listen to? So we're pretty, I think, getting pretty complicated now and pretty mature about how we handle that. So that's one example for product development. When it comes to internal businesses, typically you would know from a software development team internally, or let's say in a government scenario, you're a shared resource where you do release management, you would know your point of contacts, and those would be your customers that you're talking to. So typically it's not hard with Kanban to say who are our customers, because you first say, well, let's start with what you do now from a change principle, and you start to look for those customers that you're currently talking to. Sometimes they're direct customers, again, sometimes they are representatives, liaisons that are talking to you. But from there, we start to map out that sense of customer need and then fulfillment. And sometimes that goes from end to end, where the customer asks for something, and 2 days later or 2 weeks later, it's back in their hands completed.
Excellent. All right. Thank you, Joey. Well, I tell you what, John Stone, let me throw that same sort of question over to you with a slightly different flavor. I hear all the time people talk about Scrum has a role called the product owner. And you know what? Often that product owner is not the customer. They're not really they're not the end users. So how do you deal with that in Scrum, where you've got this product owner and they're supposed to represent the end users, but maybe they don't?
Yeah, and typically this is very common in the government environment, where there are level or multiple levels removed from actual end users. One of the things I've always done for teams is say, basically try and coach that product owner to say, you don't have to know the product intimately, but when something comes up related to something the team is working on, you know which button to push to get that person in there. I.e., you can tap a SME, you can tap an end user, you can bring them in to work with the team through a backlog refinement session, a planning or a review, whatever it happens to be, so you can get better insight into what's happening with the end users. I mentioned Spotify earlier. They took it to the extreme. They'll actually fly their customers up to New York or over to Stockholm to basically work directly with their teams, all expenses paid, because they've recognized the value of getting the customer in front of teams. That's often close to impossible with some government groups. You can't get somebody using the end system. So it could be down, we mentioned things like human-centered design and UX, leveraging some of those aspects as well. You can have that work happen up front and be fed to Scrum teams. So there's a bunch of different ways you can tackle that challenge, but you need to recognize that challenge exists. You can't just rely on that government person that happens to be your core that's now called a product owner, because they probably won't represent your end users in the best possible way.
Excellent. So, I mean, to me, that part of what you're saying in there is these frameworks, something like Scrum, doesn't necessarily cover every case. So you talked about the product owner needs to know when they need to go and ask for more information from other end users. They're not expected to know everything. What about in Safe? So for you, Brent, do you find other things that the framework is silent on, but you guys have found are really, really important to do safe effectively?
Yeah, I think one of the bigger points for us was we actually went down that road Jonathan just spoke about, and we said, all right, we're going to make our government folks the product owners. And guess what? It didn't work. So they didn't, in the framework itself, really address where exactly is the government in terms of how do they exactly fit in. And I know they recently released their Safe for Government framework, but what we ended up kind of doing is breaking our larger solutions into value streams or work streams, and a government person is assigned to each work stream, almost like a product manager, and they are responsible for 2 or 3 Scrum teams who they oversee, allowing each Scrum team to have its own product owner who actually goes out and interfaces with stakeholders or works with the HCD team to identify the work that needs to take place. So we almost sort of smushed the large solution safe and essential safe together and created sort of a hybrid model.
Okay, good. Well, let me throw over to a question from our audience. I think it's a great one, comes up quite a bit and we talk about, which is agile acquisitions. So Joey Spooner, let me throw it to you. Yeah. The question is, are there differences in these approaches for how we do acquisitions with Kanban, for example?
That is something that I'm still learning myself, to be honest, Dave. When I look at RFPs that are coming out in the past few weeks, they all tend to start with the word agile, and right after that comes Scrum. And so they're saying, I need agile Scrum. So I do believe Brent hit on something really important there, and that a lot of your current contract vehicles are set up to operate around the metrics that those frameworks provide. And that's a plus and a minus, depending on how you look at it. A lot of your contracts are usually for 5 years. So in that first year, you're probably going to blow right past your metrics. So hopefully there's a way to update that contract vehicle and get procurement done appropriately so that you can continue to evolve and improve the way you're working and get better at what you're doing, rather than hold on to some metrics that, after 6 months or 9 months or probably a year to 2 years are going to fade out and not be as valuable, yet you're still being measured against them. So in terms of procurement for Agile, there are a lot of different ways to do it, and there are a lot of vehicles out there these days. We've done it with traditional GSA IT70 schedules directly with the customers, but you can also do it through a lot of these vehicles that are out there today, like HubZone. I'm trying to think of all the ones out there, like Oasis, CIO, SP3. I don't want to get into contracting language, but some of the folks here on the call will probably understand some of those terms and acronyms. And those are different ways to actually procure it, just like a traditional other buy that you would do in the US government. I think the hardest part really is for government buyers to understand what they're looking for and what they're buying. And that's where you want to have a lot of good firms to talk to and do your homework. A lot of us are in the DC area, and most of us are available online, so you can help get better information around what's the best decision to make. I think Brent and both John would probably agree, the more flexible you are, the better off you are in terms of how you change and grow with your agile delivery.
Excellent. Well, and John, I see in the chat, one of you actually spoke to that, John Stone. You want to talk about that? What do you think in terms of doing this effectively? What do these agile contracts tend to look like?
They vary vastly across different agencies and groups from what I've seen. What I've seen in the government side of things is a shift, especially through President Obama's administration when he made a lot of the changes. As a result of what happened with the Affordable Care Act, there was just a general overhaul in how government approaches IT. If you look at some of, there was actually one that came out very recently from the VA, which was the first I've seen, which is to an extent dictating this entire contract is going to be agile. There were still some things in there which I think are still a little tight, where it mentioned, as Joey was saying, specific language, like you're going to use epics, you're going to use user stories and things like that. As I said in the chat window, you can actually constrain a team, as Joey said, for up to 5 years. And what we've been doing, both on this contract and other places I've worked, is basically just educating contract officers. There's a lot I speak to. They don't even know that there's like TechFAR guidance out there or the GSA guidance on how to actually write an agile contract. So you end up kind of sitting down with them. And one of the arguments we often get in rolling agile out is, well, we can't do that because our contract says we can't. And I know you've said this many times, Dave, when I work with you, is literally, can we see the contract? Can we actually see where it's written in the contract you can't do Agile, you can't use a backlog, you can't like develop and deliver incrementally. And when you look at it, it's usually an interpretation, it's not written in stone. So we often get the contract officers to, okay, every time you're coming up for an auction year, let's dust the contract off. Do we need to modify it to fit the way we now work? So we're effectively asking contract officers to become somewhat agile themselves.
Excellent.
Yeah. I would like to add, Dave, just the fact that I think most contract officers miss out on what Agile can really do, which is continuous improvement. And I think, you know, Sukumar had asked the question, can you provide some granular elements? If there was one element that I kind of hone in on, it would be the rate of delivery. Can you take that rate of delivery and baseline it and then improve it incrementally over time? If that's one thing I, as a contracting officer, I would look for, it's that, you know, because I've talked to people at USDS and 18F, and I think one person from USDS gave a great example of how for 18 months or 12 months, he could barely do anything with the platform he had access to. He was able to update a few pieces of it. And when he talked to his manager at USDS, I believe it was, he said, I'm horrible at this. He's like, this is the worst experience I've ever had in my life. And the manager said, well, this is really good. Sorry for the brief phone call, but you're the best one of our lot right now. So good job. Keep going. And that was an example of what's going on in the federal government between all these contracts that we're talking about here. So I think if there was a way to kind of put the gas on the pedal, is to say, guys, give us your baseline for delivery rate. We want to see maybe a minimum of X, and then we want to see you incrementally improve that using these agile techniques over time. So that then emphasizes, I think, Brent's concept, which is very common in Agile, of, you know, a feedback loop that's faster, that gives you information a little quicker, that allows you to adapt and change more effectively than just being sort of stuck in a regimented contract.
Excellent. So Brent, how about that? I mean, so we've heard from these guys about some things that may be different in these contracts. You're there at CMS, right?
Is this where the government gets beat up?
Well, we're going to try to be nice to you, you know, but yeah.
It's all fair. No, they brought up a lot of really good points. And I can tell you it's slow. It's slower than we'd like, but we are implementing some changes, at least here at CMS, around no longer creating statement of work. We create our statement of objectives. We're doing shorter periods of performance, and we're doing modular contracting. So whereas in the past we'd issue one contract to build a large system, we're picking off pieces and awarding task orders for each one of those pieces. And when those pieces are completed, that contract falls off. So we're constantly able to issue more and more smaller task orders. One of the vehicles that was instrumental in us being able to do that was establishing a blanket purchase agreement, where we had a pool of six strong, pre-vetted, agile development teams or development contractors that we could pull from at any given moment.
Excellent. All right, good. Well, I tell you what, let's change it up a little bit. I want to make sure before we get out today, and we've got, about seven more minutes, that we at least touch on pitfalls. So there's always gotchas with implementing any of these methods. So John Stone, why don't we start with you? What are some gotchas, things that people need to know about and watch for as they implement Scrum?
I think one of the biggest ones is expecting, and this kind of goes, it's not just Scrum, it's all Agile rollouts. It's the expectation that you can flick a switch and suddenly be Agile. That, okay, we're going to do Safe or Kanban or Scrum or anything, and within 3 weeks or however long your sprint is, that you're suddenly going to have working software that's fully tested, that's ready to deploy. That is rarely the case I've seen in government. One of the things I actually do with teams is actually shorten their sprint lengths if I can. So if they start with 3 weeks and they can't deliver, okay, let's do two, let's do one. To an extent, it freaks the team out, but it gets them used to actually delivering something end to end. And then we can go, okay, now we've got that small win. Let's take that and let's roll that out further. One of the other pitfalls I see is cross-comparing of teams. I see this a lot where, from a metric standpoint, they want to equate story points across teams. All that sort of stuff is really bad for an organization. If anybody on the call is hearing this where we're trying to push this, where they say, well, this team does 200 points a sprint, why are you behind only doing 100? It's all relative. It's just for that team. That's a very common pitfall in government. The other common pitfall is literally going, you core or you government person, you're now the product owner. not training them and expecting them to be effective. And this goes for Scrum Masters as well from the contractor side. I'd argue you don't necessarily need a coach for small team Scrum. Your Scrum Master should be able to operate in that role. But if they're not a career Scrum Master, you will struggle. If you take a project manager or a development lead, I'm from a military background, we always used to say you're only as good as your highest level of training. So the minute you kind of like the rubber meets the road, you will fall back to assigning work out to your developers, becoming a task master and all those sort of things. And the same goes for the government folks as well. The minute you can't deliver, they'll start being your core and cracking the whip, which is not good for the team.
Excellent. I mean, so Brent, it sounds like you got to build some expertise, right? It's not just a matter of it looks simple, you throw people in and it works. Is that the case with SAFE as well?
I think it's extremely important. You know, a prime example of that is something we see where we don't have experts and we don't have coaches in that really know what they're doing. And a team will take a ceremony like a scrum of scrums and just use it as a status update, right? Because that's what they've always done. Every week they did a status update. Now this ceremony is once a week. We're going to use this as a status update instead of what it's truly intended for. Without that expertise, you really don't have anybody to say, well, no, we got to do it this way. And then you're essentially just doing waterfall in a more complicated manner.
Excellent. So it's not just a matter of changing the terms, talking about epics and sprints and scrums. You know, the reality is, I think it sounds like for all our panelists, we've seen you can do anything poorly. You can implement Agile poorly and frankly get worse results than you got with waterfall. So I think that sounds like the common thread here. And maybe on that, let's see, what do we got? 356. So Melinda, do we want to hit one more or we think we should start wrapping up?
Should I talk about pitfalls for Kanban?
Yeah, we need one more pitfall. That'll be perfect.
Because my guess is Kanban is so easy. There are no pitfalls, right?
I was going to say, that's it. I was just going to quickly say, no pitfalls here in Kanban land. In all honesty, there's a very, very common pitfall that I think people start off with, which is they just visualize their work. And they usually have a to-do doing done because they're using Jira, to be blunt about it, in the government. That's sort of the soup du jour. And they go with that and they say, that's it. And the reality is they miss out on a lot of improvement opportunities because they're not visualizing their entire workflow. They just start off with a very simplistic workflow. And the next challenge that they run into, which people tend to shy away from, is this limiting of work in progress. It's a lot like working on a budget and saying we can only budget so much that we can work on at once. And that's where a lot of people struggle by saying, okay, how do we start to say not yet? I worked for an organization once where it was everyone had to say yes to the people who were there, who were the stakeholders. And before you knew it, we had probably something like 40 projects that were all in progress and none of them were complete. And that was a great lesson for the director of the division to say, wait a minute, maybe we should start saying not yet instead of yes. And I was like, there you go. So that's probably the second pitfall is not saying an informed way of saying not yet. So those are two common ones. And the last one, which I think John hit on really well, is having people who are suddenly there on site to be a certain kind of person, like the front end person who handles all the requests, or what's called a service delivery manager in Kanban, which handles the day-to-day operations and running of the work. It's quite likely that they're not trained and that they're just going to just fly with it. And that's a low maturity behavior. And just a quick little snippet there. I've seen a number of consultants from, you know, a number of firms that come into government now, and they say, this is my ex, you know, master or ex person. And that person's just barely gotten the rudimentary training or not at all. And they're fresh out of college. So for those on the phone, if you haven't sent them to training, please send them to training because they will benefit you greatly overall.
Yeah, I'll say though, and thank you, Joey. I think one of the things that all of you sort of echoed is, look, you know, training is a first step, but building the expertise takes a lot of time. So nothing against recent college graduates, but, you know, to implement this stuff effectively, it is a change and it takes time to build that expertise. So outstanding. Thank you. Thank you to all of our panelists. Melinda, I'll turn it back over to you.
Great. Thank you. Yes, we'll wrap up quickly. Thank you again to all the panelists so much for being here today. I'm chatting in their LinkedIn profiles. You can connect with them later about extra questions you may have. I'm sure they'd be happy to engage. We have our book giveaway. So the winner today for the Kanban book is Bonnie Wolf. And if you're here and you'd like the book, just type yay in the chat or unmute and let me know that you'd like to have it. And if not, we'll go on to the next. Yay! Okay, she wants the book.
Way to go, Bonnie.
Yeah, good job. Thanks for being here today, and I will connect with you after to mail that to you. So I think that takes us to the wrap. Once again, thank you for being here. This is AGL Association. Here is the links again to our website and to membership. And thank you all so much for joining us today. Take care, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.